What I'd like to tell you about today is a new center that we've won from the National Science Foundation. And this is aimed at making atomic scale electrons, devices, and systems. This shows, actually, it's sort of the time scale of my life, if you like, where I was born just before 1950. I'm officially old, which is nice. Somebody my age, you get discounts at hotels. It's wonderful. But I've seen what's happened to the electronics since the 1950s through the current time. And you've all heard about Moore's Law and how things blow up exponentially in power. But you can go back to some things I remember, like the first CHIRT radio after the invention of the transistor in the 1950s. It had four transistors. There it says $25, but if you multiply by inflation, it costs about the same as an iPod, about $200. And people were really thrilled to walk around with the radio with them. It wasn't until the 1970s that we got computer chips. Intel made their first chip in 1971. And it was another decade before we got really laptop computers that you could take home and use. But things have kept going until you get a nice Macintosh Air computer, such as the one I'm showing you here. But what's happened in the past 10 years is we've had a whole new type of material called quantum materials that are both atomic sized, and then their very operation uses quantum mechanics. Inside silicon transistors, the particles move more or less like BBs, and the kind of thing you can understand by throwing baseballs, but this is really quite different. And so the first question then, what is an atom, and how did it come to be, and what is quantum about it? And this actually goes back to Democritus in the Greeks. Here's a statue of him in the 6th century BC. And they wondered, what is matter made of? What is this table made of? What are we made of? And the idea was that if you take it apart, these are little Lego blocks, and you get smaller and smaller bits, that there's some limit where it becomes uncuttable into smaller pieces. And in Greek, that's called atomos, which means uncuttable. And in this case, we're going down to the Lego blocks. And then the furthermore, each one of these Lego blocks is exactly, precisely, the same as the other one. What this is an enormous simplification. Ed Purcell, one of the best Harvard professors, was giving a talk about quantum, and he supposed that you had two atoms, but that they actually had names. Here are two that have different colors. One is called Bill and the other is called Jane, and then they have different personalities. And then you're going to put a billion of these together and understand what goes on. It would be totally impossible. But in quantum mechanics, they're absolutely precisely the same. And that if I switch them like this, you would not be able to tell that it's different at all. And it took people about 2,000 years to really figure out what that means. But it really is fantastic and is sort of the ultimate small size that you can go to. An electronic computer, the way that they work now, is to have a little circuit. You have a battery on the left, and then everything is connected by wires, and then an electron will move through the wires through a switch that you close to store a bit of memory, and then that electron will sit on the memory site. And that's the way that this computer here works and other computers go. And the way that they go is by the flow of atoms, these particles, through a device, through a wire, and onto a memory. And those are the three things that you need to make it work. And conventional computers use the charge on the electron moving around to convey information. But this costs a lot of energy, and the amount of energy burned is the big limit to making silicon go further. And so what we'll do in these atomic electrons is to actually use the spin of an electron. It turns out each electron is a little bit like a bar magnet, and the North Pole can point up, or the North Pole can point down, and so you can store a bit of information as being that's a one and that's a zero. And let me show you how that works. This gives a picture of the progress of electronics over the past 50 years. And on the left, this is actually where I started out when I was a kid. We had vacuum tubes, and they're about this big. They generate a lot of heat, and they burn out. My TV set, I had to replace the vacuum tubes by going to the drugstore and find the right tube. And this shows a fellow looking at a computer that's made out of vacuum tubes. And so each vacuum tube is one switch. And here's the Nobel Prize winners that invented the transistor. And they're using a microscope to look at one transistor because it's a lot smaller. Okay. And then finally, if you move to my good Mac Air computer, it actually uses an Intel integrated circuit that has over a billion transistors on it. And that's the kind of progress which has made electronics so powerful. But what's happened is the silicon, you can only make it so small, and it stops working. And it does that at sizes that are much bigger than the size of an atom. And what's happened now is it stalled. And to make one of the world's most powerful computers, the Sequoia up here, requires the equivalent of a billion of these MacBook Airs connected together. And that's why it's so big. They would like to make one that's 1,000 times quicker, but then you need a billion instead of a million Airs connected together. And what it actually looks like is the whole world on the internet all at one time. And it's good for certain things, like half of the world could look at the other half and understand what they're doing. This is what Google does and some other people do. But if you want to solve a big problem, it's not too good. And so what we're doing is to really look at things that go all the way down to the atomic scale. We use three materials, graphene, which makes ultra-fast devices. There's a picture of a graphene lattice. This is kind of an atom picture of it, or model, where each one of these joints is a carbon atom, and then they're joined by bonds into this hexagonal lattice. And the whole thing is only one atom thin, or thick, and so it's incredibly thin, and it's also incredibly tough and strong. The second one is a mysterious material called a topological insulator that's a perfect wire where you can send data without it being corrupted. I'll show you how that works. And then the last one is just diamond. It turns out their color centers, they make diamond change color. You can store one bit of information on one atom inside a diamond. And so let me start off first with diamond. These are the people that are involved in the research. And so diamond you're all familiar with through beautiful rings. It has incredible properties. It's really transparent. Incredibly hard. It likes to make really strong crystals and is something we've understood for thousands of years. But only within the last 10 years, it turns out you can use something that's called color centers in order to act as memory bits. What we're looking at here are little crystallites of a diamond, and you'll notice that they're different colors. Some of them are orange. They actually have nitrogen in them. Other ones are sort of a beautiful blue color. They have boron atoms inside them, and others are different colors. And this shows how that works. And the fact that these colors existed was known for a long time, but the fact they were so useful wasn't. What happens if you have just one nitrogen atom in the crystal is shown here. The spin on that nitrogen atom can hold one bit of information. And you can write it with a photon, a bit of light, to program it up or down. And that remembers at room temperature that information for as long as the memory chip in my computer does. And so this means that the size of a memory bit just went all the way down to one atom. And this actually really works. And one of Marco Longcar, one of our investigators has found how to make this into a device. And here's a picture of Marco on the left. And this is actually a single crystal of diamond that's been cut up to a bunch of nanowires. Each one holds one of these centers. And as shown in the picture on the left, you can then program that with light and then use a light beam to actually read out each one. So this raises the possibility of making an atomic scale network, atomic scale computer, where these spins talk with each other in a programmed way, it can do things like pattern recognition and signal processing and the like. The next one, it's a protected data channel. That is a wire that will send a bit of information in a way that cannot be corrupted. It's topologically protected. And if you look at the picture, you'll see that the red bits go clockwise around the edge of a sample, and the blue ones go counterclockwise. And it turns out by geometry, this must always be true. And so how could that possibly be true? And so fortunately, I found pictures of two women, one in red and one in blue. And suppose that you look at the topology means shape. And suppose you look at a person. Well, everybody has a left hand and you have a right hand. And there's nothing that you can do that will make your left hand turn into the right hand. And so if I want to follow around this table, I can put my left hand on the table. I can even close my eyes and then walk around the table using my left hand to guide me. And I'll always go around it counterclockwise like this. Likewise, if I use my right hand, I will always go clockwise. And there's absolutely no way I can turn around. You can try this yourself in your kitchen or living room, and just put one hand on the wall, close your eyes, and off you go. And so that's the way it works. In a topological insulator, it's able to do that kind of guidance quantum mechanically. And this shows a nice graphic from a new Geddick that shows the quantum version where we have the electron spins. If you see this little gadget, looks like the picture, being written by a photon that's coming in from the outside world, and then that spin gets transmitted perfectly from one place to the other. And then the final part is we get back to graphene. And it's interesting how this was discovered, first by André Geim. He won the Nobel Prize for this because of the impact it had. And people know that graphite, you make a pencil out of it. It's been known for a long time that you take a piece of graphite and you write on a piece of paper, that little layers flake off, and that's the way that a pencil works. But it's been studied really for decades. But nobody thought that you could just lift one layer, one atomic layer, off of the graphite. But Geim is an amazing guy. He actually has with the graphite, he said there's an easy way to pick it off, is you just take some scotch tape, you take a crystal of graphite, you go whap like this, it pulls some of it off, and you go ding, 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 ding. And then you look at it under a microscope and you actually can pull out the single atomic layers. And it actually worked. He just has sort of guts and he's very smart too, and they say, why not? And this is a picture of the very rock and the scotch tape that he used. And graphene has this structure that it's a hexagonal crystal, as I've shown here, and it's made entirely of carbon. It turns out to be incredibly strong, and it's even sort of matched to put on top of silicon. It's the same number of electrons per atom. And this shows the kind of picture of both what the graphite and the graphene look like. But these are some real pictures. I know that Carolyn tells me not everybody believes that atoms exist, so I'm going to show you some atomic resolution pictures in a high-resolution electron microscope where you can see what the individual atoms do. And so on the left is a picture in a high-resolution transmission electron microscope that looks just like this, where you can see the hexagonal lattice. What we've done in the middle is just put a little bit of silicon on it, and you can see the silicon atoms because they're more bright. And on the right, it shows you where the silicon sit. And in this case, they're going fixed in particular places. But what we'd like to do is to make atomic scale devices that are really atomic scale, that is some number of electrons across. And how do you do that? One way to do it is to actually use the atomic, the silicon atoms, is atomic chisels. This is sitting in an electron beam with 80 very energetic 80 keV electrons blasting through. And when the silicon is there, it acts like a catalyst that just chops one carbon away. And in this time-lapse photos, you can see the silicon atom is skating around the inside of a hole, making it wider and wider. So this is the Michelangelo of graphene. And the final one I'd like to show you is a picture that demonstrates how strong the carbon is. And this is actually an atomic wire. One of my, William Gibson is a famous sci-fi man, and one of the bad guys in his stories pulls the end of his finger out, and then there's atomic wire pulls out the end of his finger, and then he and then cuts people into bits. And it sounds like fantasy, but if you actually look in this picture, you can see the chains of carbon atoms that cross this hole, and that's just one carbon after the other. And the whole thing is so strong that if you click this, you can watch a movie in real time that shows that atomic wire dancing along. So this is the kind of game that we're playing by cutting things up with electron beams and looking with atomic resolution where they go. We're beheaded toward atomic electronics. And so this is a picture of the all of the people involved. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Bob. That was terrific.